This Regency house has strong historic links to the sea, much like the county I'm in. Find out where I am and whose home this was in just a moment. Today's move is all about new beginnings and new ventures.
We hoped we'd be challenged. This is an unusual property, but it's very attractive.
And our properties take country living to a whole new level.
So how much is the acreage in total?
Oh, just over 46 and a half acres.
No.
46 and a half acres.
I'm in North Devon, and this is Arlington Court, ancestral home to the Chichester family. Now, one notable descendant you may well have heard of is yachtsman Sir Francis Chichester, who in 1967 became the first man to sail solo around the world in just 9 months and one day, and received a knighthood from the Queen for his seafaring efforts. This echoes a zeal for world travel from his Victorian predecessor, Rosalie Chichester, who built up a vast collection of seashells and model boats, which visitors to this beautiful estate can come and see. That is, if they can tear themselves away from such a stunning setting. In the heart of England's West Country, the county of Devon stretches from the English Channel in the south to the Bristol Channel in the north. It's here in North Devon that over 100 square miles of magnificent protected coastal landscapes run from the Cornish border to Exmoor National Park. They range from coastal cliffs and rugged coves to beautiful clean beaches such as Putsborough Sands, a draw for surfing enthusiasts. Further down the coast, the colourful quayside village of Appledore sits at the point where the Tar and Torridge rivers unite. Its history as a fishing village goes back to the 14th century and continues today. The larger Victorian seaside town of Ilfracombe is characterised by its geographical setting, with its rocky coastline plunging into the sea. It's also home to other arresting landmarks, including a huge sculpture presented to the town by artist Damien Hirst. His 65-foot-high bronze artwork, called Verity, divides opinion. Inland, the wilderness of Exmoor National Park is made up of some 250 square miles of undulating moorland, of which a third sits in Devon, and the rest edges over into Somerset. A common sight on the moors are the handsome native Exmoor ponies, just one of the many draws of this diverse county. Buying a slice of Devon property can put a dent in your wallet. The average price for a detached house here comes in at a touch over £356,000. That's £25,000 above the national figure. And furthermore, homes by the sea in desirable places like Croyde in the north or Salcombe in the south can be anything up to 70% more expensive than similar properties found further inland. Something worth bearing in mind as we meet today's buyers and find out what their grand ambitions are. City marketer Lorraine and her retired IT manager husband Nigel met 10 years ago in a thoroughly modern way.
Well, Lorraine picked me out on a well-known internet dating site. I don't think I'd have picked her out because she was outside my age group.
We were a good match.
We were a good match. Married just about a year afterwards.
After 9 years of marriage, the couple have only good things to say about each other.
Lorraine is a very beautiful, talented Irish girl from Northern Ireland. Loves the countryside, loves walking, and is very good with people.
Nigel's an incredibly kind guy, and we've been enjoying marriage second time round.
Their dynamic clearly works.
Nigel does have a very dry sense of humour, which occasionally ruffles feathers. As a lot of our friends know, I have a reputation for coming along behind and smoothing over some of the ruffled feathers.
For the past 5 years, the couple have lived in their five-bedroom home near Redhill in Surrey, which is within earshot of Gatwick Airport.
This area is fantastic, but it's getting busier and more congested. And we do live near the airport, which is huge advantages. But, you know, over the years, I know that's going to get busier. And so we would love to take this opportunity to get away to somewhere more peaceful.
Well, ideally, I'd like to move to North Devon because you get the best of the countryside and you're never that far from the coastline. We often have holidays down in that part of the world and the dogs just love it.
An ambitious move is on the cards for this active couple and their four dogs, but not at the expense of relaxing. Having watched Nigel enjoy his retirement for the past 7 years, Lorraine's decided she wants to follow in his footsteps.
With Lorraine at home, I'll be able to spend more time on some of my hobbies that I just don't have time for today, such as wood turning, beekeeping, I enjoy fishing, walking with the dogs, cycling in the countryside. And I'm looking forward to spending more time on all those activities when my wife retires.
Lorraine has plans of her own too.
Yeah, well, certainly music is a great passion in my life. I studied as a musician. So one of the things I'm looking forward to in my retirement is being able to have time to play more and maybe go back to teaching piano, which I used to enjoy.
She's always busy. So even if she's watching soaps on the TV, she'll be knitting or making some sort of crocheted animal.
But it won't all be downtime. They've already taken steps towards country living, having acquired 15 alpacas, which they breed and sell. But they want to build on that in the next phase of their countryside adventure.
We hope that we'll be able to have a business together. If it's not involving the alpacas, it might be a holiday let business. My family live in Ireland, with our daughter living in London. When we move, they'll have to come and stay, and it would be great to have space for them to do that.
With a house on the market and plenty of dreams for a change of lifestyle, Lorraine and Nigel are all set to begin the search for their new country pad.
I was brought up in a small fishing village in Northern Ireland, very much a rural community, and I'd love to have the chance to live like that again.
And I think now's a good time, while we're young enough, to go and do something different together, to make a move.
Lorraine and Nigel have earmarked the North Devon countryside as their perfect destination and would preferably want to be around 20 minutes from the coast. I'm meeting up with them in the county to go over their property requirements.
What is drawing you to a new life in Devon then?
One of the things we'd like to do is run a bit of a lifestyle business in our retirement. So we are ideally looking for something with some sort of revenue potential.
Okay.
Be it holiday letting or something else.
Have you got a type, style or period of property in mind that you'd like to have a look at here?
Not so much tied to that, but what we would like is a bit more lateral living in the downstairs area, somewhere I could put a piano.
Okay.
It's quite right. A priority. I would like a nice large kitchen. Mm-hmm. In good order.
I'm more interested in the outbuildings and the land. My requirements in the house might be a few racks so I can put my comic collection somewhere safe. Anything eco-friendly would be great.
Minimum 3 bedrooms.
Yeah.
Let's talk outside space. How much do you want?
Well, we've said that we'd like a minimum of 10 acres.
What about location itself? Do you want to be close to other people?
Edge of a village would be great. We're both very social people. We'd be happy to get involved in a local community.
So how much are you looking to spend on this new life of yours?
I think for the right property, we're willing to spend up to about £1.1 million.
OK, that's a really healthy budget. Shall we get going?
Yes, please.
Push this way.
Thank you.
With their generous budget of £1.1 million, Lorraine and Nigel would like a property with spacious living quarters, a large kitchen, room for a baby grand piano and 3 bedrooms. They also want the potential to run holiday lets and are hoping for at least 10 acres of land. Nigel would like outbuildings for his wood turning and other hobbies. Location-wise, they'd like to be close to a community they could become part of. We've lined up 3 thought-provoking properties and after each tour, I'll reveal the price tag once they've had a guess first. Our last stop to the Mystery House will go above and beyond their wish list, challenging them on how much of the good life they really want.
What about this land, OK? Yeah. I know you've got alpacas, but Have you got aspirations or dreams of doing anything else with the land? Anything different?
If there is a letting side to all of this, that we could have yachts and camping.
Yeah, that'd be fun, wouldn't
having, you know, nicely kept grounds and alpacas definitely lends itself to that.
When you've got an enterprise attached to a house, I think that just drives you further and further into having more fun and engaging with what's here.
There is a feeling from our friends that people staying at our place would be a bit like Fawlty Towers. I'd probably be Basil and Lorraine would be Sybil.
Our North Devon house hunt starts on the outskirts of the village of Paracombe, found on the western edge of Exmoor and just 20 minutes from the coast. This quiet community has fewer than 400 residents, living within its pretty sloping lanes lined with stone cottages. Locals have the use of a dining pub, a village shop and post office, and an artisan pottery shop. Just over 2 miles outside the village, in a rural setting with footpaths to the coast, we've arrived at our first property, or should I say, collection of properties.
This is what we're going to be looking at. Everything you can see.
There's a lot here.
There is a lot. It's beautiful.
I'm gutted the weather isn't great at the moment, because even though you can see just a little hint of some hills over that way.
Yeah. No, it's very quiet as well. Lovely.
Really impressive.
So we get out of the weather and I'll explain more about this place's history once we're inside. Yeah?
Perfect. Super. Yeah.
Come on. Thank you.
This character stone farmhouse dates back to the mid-18th century, but the current owners have spent over 25 years renovating it after it fell to rack and ruin. It's topped with reclaimed slate roof tiles and has been sympathetically modernised throughout. We're entering via a hallway decked with a smart slate floor and heading straight for the farmhouse kitchen, which provides access to the garden.
Right then.
Lovely kitchen.
Ah.
It's gorgeous, isn't it?
It's really lovely.
Amazing. Yeah. Dining area.
Very nice space. Could definitely see myself in here. There's plenty of entertaining space, which is a big deal for us.
Now, through here, they used to milk cows here. And that used to be the milkmaid's quarters.
All right.
So there's the opportunity to self-contain this because there's bedroom and bathroom accommodation upstairs, and then you've got a kitchen and a living room. So you could self-contain that, and then it could be holiday lets.
Gosh, yeah.
Okay. If you didn't have aspirations to play a piano in the house. Otherwise,
very clever.
Piano room.
Very clever.
As well as what is currently a snug and a utility room on this side of the kitchen, on the other side, there's a well-proportioned sitting room which opens onto a terrace.
Now, very light, bearing in mind the bones of this property are centuries old.
Lovely window seat.
Oh, yeah, look at the view.
Watch your alpacas graze upon your fields.
Just what you want.
I think it's the feel of the house for me, actually.
So far, so very positive, and there's much more on offer here. Upstairs, on the side of the house, which sits above the kitchen and sitting room, there's a beautiful, traditionally styled family bathroom with a freestanding bath. There are three double bedrooms up here. One has an attractive window seat, and the master features split-level windows. In addition to the three bedrooms on this side of the house, there's a single bedroom and a double on the other side of the property above the snug, bringing the total to five. Having taken in the main house, we're heading outside to explore the three converted stone barns, which have already been turned into self-contained holiday lets. Last year, they provided an income of £30,000, so a high-spec business to take on.
Up we go. We'll keep you fit living here.
We're visiting the largest of the three converted barns. Situated on the ground floor is a contemporary kitchen diner, a large double bedroom, and also a twin and a snug single. Above all that, there's a room which really makes a statement.
You can see why they chose to use the upstairs as a living room, can't you, for this cottage?
It's a beautiful room, yes. That's wonderful.
Look at all the beams, nice.
You've got a bridle way that takes you straight down to the coast and to a pub.
Wow.
No.
Just there.
Perfect.
That's a happy man.
Yeah. Perfect for you and your guests.
Yeah.
So.
Excellent.
Yeah, I like
it. Thank you.
start thinking about price. How much would you pay for the home and the income?
Right.
This property has so much to offer. As well as an established business, it comes with outbuildings and plenty of land, all set in gorgeous countryside.
So here we are.
It's beautiful, it's really impressive.
You get 16 acres in total.
Right.
But you also get access to some common grazing land as well, which is about 17 acres.
All right.
The alpacas.
Yeah.
So how much do you think you're going to have to pay?
Dreading this question.
So I'm going to say it's probably near the top end of our budget. Mm-hmm. At least £1.1 million.
Okay.
Yeah. I think I'm going to go for the million just because of the rural nature of the location.
Good guess is the asking price for this place is £950,000.
Oh my.
Right.
The reason why it's probably cheaper than you imagine is because there's an agricultural tie to this property. Whoever buys this place has to use this land for agricultural purposes.
With the beekeeping and the alpacas, we absolutely respect that.
I want you to go and have a look around everything that's here, walk the land. I've got the owner to draw this up for you. It's a map.
Oh, thank
Don't
you.
Get it wet. Enjoy it, all right?
All right.
Absolutely.
See you in a bit.
Thanks. Thank you.
This wonderfully renovated stone farmhouse dating back almost 300 years has rung in £150,000 under their top budget. It has a great entertaining kitchen, a large sitting room and five bedrooms. There are also three established holiday lets and 16 acres of land.
Well, it's a lovely hilly paddock, this, but the alpacas wouldn't mind that.
They love that.
They'd nibble all these bushes and trees, so that would save me a job. I was surprised at the number of buildings. I mean, I was expecting sort of one farmhouse, and I looked around and we had several separate standalone units. And I like the fact that the main farmhouse isn't that big, it's manageable. And it's a nice cozy feel, it's light and airy.
From outside, I thought it was a very, very pretty property. The first thing I thought was, yes, I could live here. And that's a very important first impression.
So, all done?
Yep.
Have you seen everything here that you need to?
We have, and there's a lot to see.
Isn't there?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hopefully there's a lot to see maybe on a second viewing. We'll have to wait and see. Ready for another one?
Yes.
Yes, we are.
In North Devon, you're never far from some dramatic coastline. And when Lorraine and Nigel make their move here, they're planning to reignite their passion for sailing, a shared hobby they haven't had time to enjoy recently. They've come to Ilfracombe Harbour on the North Devon coast to meet John Clements. He's the ex-commodore of Ilfracombe Yacht Club and has been sailing the seas since the 1960s, including navigating the Atlantic twice. So he's just the man to get them back on the water.
So, John, how long have you been sailing from Ilfracombe?
Well, I actually bought my first sailing boat in 1975, but having lived here all my life, I've always been playing with boats. It's a good sailing area, very good.
Yeah. There's a lot around here to go nearby?
There's a lot of lovely places to see. You've got Lundy Island, Clovelly, Lynmouth, all within an easy day's sail.
And the sailing conditions around here, are they challenging?
Well, anywhere else, you get good days like today, or you can get days where you really don't want to be out there. The Bristol Channel is a bit challenging. Because,
yeah,
of its tides. Yeah. The main thing to learn here, or to master, is the tides.
The Bristol Channel is the biggest natural inlet in the UK, with the largest tidal range in the world at 14 metres. Lorraine and Nigel are going to get the chance to experience it on board John's boat, Eliane.
Right, Lorraine, I'll start the engine.
John bought her in 1980, sold her 8 years later, and missed her so much, he bought her back again in 2000.
OK, we're out to clear the harbour, let's try and put the sails up and see if we can catch a bit of wind. Right, Lorraine, if you'd like to take the helm, and just, I'll go on deck, just steer her that way. Nigel, you're on the halyard. Right, pull it away gently, I'll make sure everything runs free.
OK.
Eliane's sail is 35 feet tall, and when it fills with wind, it drives the 66-ton, 29-foot-long boat forward.
Up you go. Go on. That's it. All the way. Keep going.
All the way.
Yeah, keep going. Yep. Right, that's it.
Yep.
That's the sail up.
All right.
We'll get out, see if we can get a bit of wind.
Ilfracombe Harbour is the largest harbour on the North Devon coast, with a centuries-old history as a port. It's Nigel's turn at the helm.
And I can feel the effect of the tide running against the tiller here. It's quite strong.
Well, you've got a strong tide against us at the moment, but we're not going far. You see the speed over there, that says 6 knots. That's
right.
The speed the boat is actually going through the water.
Uh-huh.
But if you look on the chart plotter, it's down to 4.2.
Yeah.
So we've got 2 knots of tide against us.
So you have to work that all out for your timings.
You do plan your destination and what time you're going to leave to use the tide to your advantage. Yeah.
Absolutely beautiful here, John. Where are we heading to?
Well, there's a couple of very nice bays here. There's a nice little harbour, which I'll take you in a minute, which is called Watermouth. Just like to show you that, and then we'll head back.
Lovely.
Before long, Eliane sweeps into the calm waters of secluded Watermouth Bay so that John can share one of Devon's little gems.
This is quite a nice little harbour.
Yeah, it's a chap fishing there. Look at that, that's pretty.
After taking in the turquoise waters of the bay, it's back to Ilfracombe Harbour to complete their round trip.
John, it's been fantastic. Thank you very much. We've had such a wonderful time.
Yeah, no, thanks, John, for getting us out here. It's beautiful.
Pleasure to have you on the boat, and you've had a perfect day for it, and I'll see you again.
Yeah, we'll be back soon.
As they reach dry land, it's time to turn our attention to their house hunt. Our next property stop is outside the village of Pyeworthy, to the west of the county, close to the border with Cornwall and just 8 miles from the coast. The handsome village church, St Swithin's, is Grade 2 listed with a star. And there's also a family-run dining pub and a recreation ground for locals to enjoy. Just over 3 miles away is our next offering, this period farmhouse.
Lovely.
Lovely. I like the sound of that.
Yeah.
It's really, it's really pretty. Beautiful.
So we like what we see.
Yep.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
It doesn't give a lot away. I mean, the owner couldn't actually place a date on this property. Yep. Part of it will be a couple of hundred years old.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It looks cosy, it looks easy to maintain.
Let's go inside.
This traditional farmhouse is built from cob and stone, but its period exterior masks a very different style inside. The entrance porch leads us straight into an open-plan kitchen diner.
Yeah, got a very nice feeling about this one.
Oh, good. Probably not what you're expecting.
Not at all.
A bit more modern. Perfect. Mm-hmm.
You get such lovely natural light in here, clean lines everywhere. So in this room, you've got a back door, which is the door you'd always use, isn't it? Mm-hmm. With a utility, that's your boot room.
Lovely.
Between here and the living room, you've got another reception room, which I think you might put your piano.
This house certainly offers Lorraine the lateral living space she was after with its open plan flow.
Now, this is one bright, airy room.
It's beautiful.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, I like the ceiling. You know, that's nice.
This is very contemporary, but you seem to be responding quite well to it.
Well, we hoped we'd be challenged. This is an unusual property. It's very attractive.
You know, you're going to move into this house tomorrow. Yeah. Mm-hmm. What are you going to do to it?
Well, I would put my piano down there and turn that all into a library.
Nice, OK. What happens to the room we've just walked through?
Study and comic library.
Brilliant! OK, good. So far, so good.
Yep.
Let's go upstairs.
After taking in the high-spec, minimalist features of the ground floor, we're moving to the first floor, where a stylish monochrome family bathroom services 3 double bedrooms. 2 are currently set up as children's rooms, but the largest of the 3 is the one Lorraine and Nigel would use.
Right, a decent-sized bedroom.
Yeah, it's a good size.
Lovely, yeah.
I've rarely get the opportunity to show someone an old building that is such a blank canvas.
I'd actually quite enjoy being given this kind of a canvas to make my own. So that I would quite like.
Now, in this property, you get another property to let out. It's adjoining this house.
The holiday let sits to the right of the house, the majority of which is in a converted barn. The current owners use it as guest accommodation. There's a well-equipped contemporary kitchen opening onto a beautiful living room with a vaulted and beamed ceiling. There's also a good-sized bedroom and a bathroom on the ground floor. Then, built into the loft is a large bedroom with a third room on a mezzanine level. But that's not the only extra that comes with this property. In the grounds, another converted barn is currently used as a playroom with a study above it. There's also a collection of farm buildings to be found in this rather expansive setting, which could provide housing for hobbies and alpacas. Finally, there's pasture, woodland and ponds, with the land bringing in an income.
We've had a bit of a walk. You've seen a lot of land, haven't you?
Yes.
Yeah.
So how much is the acreage in total?
Oh, just over 46 and a half acres.
No.
46 and a half acres?
Yeah.
Wow.
Amazing.
Have a guess at this price.
Oh, this is really difficult. It's really difficult.
I'm thinking it's going to be a bit less than the first house. So I'm going to guess about £950,000.
OK.
I'm going to go under that, and I would think about £850,000.
Not far off, Nigel. The asking price for this property is £975,000.
That's
attractive.
Yeah. That is interesting, yeah.
Well, you've got plenty of land to go and have a look at. 46 and a half acres. See as much as you can, all right?
Thank you.
In a bit.
This farmhouse has been renovated to an extremely high standard and is priced £125,000 under the top budget. It comes with both period character and contemporary style. There's an open-plan kitchen diner, perfect for entertaining, and three bedrooms in the main house, plus a three-bedroom holiday let. Externally, there are a number of outbuildings sitting in over 46 acres.
I think it's a beautifully kept property. It's very pretty, and first impressions were really strong. There's only one holiday let, so that obviously reduces the income potential at the moment against a much larger parcel of land, so that's something to think about.
The house hasn't got a lot of space in it, so we just have to get used to that. But certainly the outbuildings for the land have got great potential, and I could see us developing a good alpaca business here.
So, well done, I reckon. Is that two potential contenders we've seen today?
It is, actually.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, both certainly within budget as well.
Excellent. Well, something to think about and chat about over dinner.
Yep.
Let's start afresh tomorrow.
Perfect.
It's the second day of our trip around North Devon, looking for an epic country property with land for Lorraine and Nigel from the town of Redhill in Surrey for their four dogs and 15 alpacas. They've got a top budget of £1.1 million. Coming up, a super-sized mystery house for all the family.
Can your alpacas swim?
No. They like to paddle.
Right.
And I learn all about the power of water.
Sounds so simple now it's invented and up and running, but what a genius idea. Well, I think after yesterday's two strong contenders, I'm very much looking forward to showing Nigel and Lorraine the mystery house. But I've got to tell you, apart from its quirky layout, this house gives them pretty much everything they've asked for. There doesn't really seem to be any compromise, just bags and bags of extras. Let's see, here we go.
Our last stop to the mystery house takes us to the rural hamlet of Chiller, about half an hour from the coast. Just over 2 miles away, all the necessities can be found in the village of Howell Junction, named after a railway station which opened in 1879 and closed just over 100 years later. Today, there's a village shop, a friendly dining pub, and a post office. Just over a 5-minute drive away is our third and final property set in the midst of rural splendour.
Now, this truly is a mystery house.
It certainly is.
It's a little unusual.
This is certainly that. This property was built back in 2002 by the current owners. He's a builder. His son was an architect who designed it.
Okay.
And they designed it to make the most of this beautifully rural environment.
Yeah, stunning. Yeah.
Brace yourselves, come with me.
Our unique mystery house is built from Cotswold stone, but has the look of a Mediterranean villa, completely unexpected in this part of the world. It's laid out over different levels and offers views at every turn. The main entrance leads us to a staircase, taking us up to the main living areas.
So, this is some entrance hall, is it not?
It certainly is. Wow. It's very impressive.
That's so amazing.
How do you get over there?
Through one of the reception rooms.
Ah, I see.
Shall we start with the living room, because it's a lovely space. Come with me.
The rooms on this level fan off from this vast reception hall. First, we're heading to the huge sitting room at the back.
So.
Lovely, lovely room.
Good size. It's kind of all open plan, but it's very warm in here. It feels comfortable. Mm.
There are three levels to this property, but most of your residential accommodation is all on this mid-level.
Where's the piano going?
Could go down there.
Let's keep looking around.
Let's go.
Just on the other side of the sitting room is the kitchen.
A kitchen in this house is just that, just a kitchen, maybe a breakfast kitchen.
It's very nice.
Got more cupboards than we've ever seen in the kitchen.
What a view to have your breakfast to explore.
Isn't that just stunning?
Absolutely lovely.
Happy lady.
Very much.
Modern kitchen. Mm-hmm.
Perfect. Let's keep looking around.
Back across the hallway is the master bedroom.
Gosh.
Big enough?
Definitely big enough. With an incredible, incredible view.
And incredible storage. That door leads us through to the reading area.
Uh-huh. All right.
But this, well, that's a walk-in wardrobe for someone. But I think the owners that built this place have been to America and seen the vastness of the ensuite you get over there. Because look at this!
Fantastic.
That is brilliant.
Unbelievable.
I'm so glad Lorraine and Nigel seem as blown away with this stunning property as I am. Also on this floor, there's a dining room which, like so many of the rooms here, has a Juliet balcony. Next door, there's a bright, dual-aspect guest bedroom. And across the hall is a large study. Above the first floor and accessed by a spiral stairway is a fabulous space known as the tower, with 360-degree glazing making the most of the panoramic views. Time to head to the opposite end of this exceptional house. It's on the lower level that I want to show Lorraine and Nigel something they're not expecting.
No. This is what they've done with the downstairs.
Fabulous.
Perfect. Perfect. Wow. And a jacuzzi.
Yep.
Oh, this has got to be for us. I want it.
Oh, there you go.
I do.
Unbelievable.
What a party you could have in this house. This is a party palace, this is.
It really is, isn't it?
It's fantastic. Yeah.
Should we go outside?
Yeah.
Come with me.
As well as this surprising element in our mystery house, the ground floor also has a self-contained unit which could be let out. There's an open-plan kitchen diner, a bright living room, and a double bedroom. There's also an integral garage and storeroom. And in the extensive grounds, there are two stables, plus a two-bedroom timber lodge. Yet more holiday let potential. Outside, the beautiful gardens and land can be appreciated from the terraces, not to mention a 2-acre lake, home to four islands.
Welcome to Barbecue Island. That's
fabulous.
The name.
Really? Seriously?
Yeah.
What an entertaining spot this is.
Can your alpacas swim?
No. They like to paddle.
Right. Well, if they don't like to paddle, they want dry land, you've got that too.
Really?
And you've got woodland. All in all, you've got 24 acres of land here.
That's about perfect.
So, who wants to have a stab at guessing the price?
This is going to be really right through our budget. I think it's going to be 1.4.
So I'm going to
hopefully go for £1.2 million.
Not far off. The asking price of this, it's quite specific because of the land, is £1,100,062.
No. Well, we could just about do that.
It's amazing.
It is meant to be, I think.
I want you to go and have a look around all this here. And I'll be marking out the boundaries and I'm coming up with some new legislation for my own island here. All right? See you in a bit.
All right.
Thank you.
Thanks, Shelley.
This extraordinary mystery house and all that comes with it has nudged just £62 over budget. It has a contemporary kitchen, ample entertaining space and three bedrooms. Then there's the tower with its panoramic vistas, the indoor swimming pool and the lake. There are two existing holiday let options with scope for more, all located in a tranquil 24 acres of beautiful scenery.
Oh my goodness, what a room.
Wow.
Oh, look at that.
What a view.
It's been just an unfolding series of good surprises. I think the layout's fantastic, lots of lateral living. So for our purposes, it fulfills the wish list and then some.
The mystery property offers so much of what we were looking for. It would be ideal for Lorraine and I, but it wasn't what I was expecting at all, so it was a true mystery house.
I'm exhausted thinking about how much you've had to have a look around on your own.
Yeah, it's a lot of house.
Epic house, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's an amazing house. It's absolutely perfect.
Well, I'm glad you've got something to think about. Do just that now over the next couple of hours and we'll meet up later on.
Brilliant.
Come on then.
Okay.
For centuries, Exmoor National Park's geography and high rainfall has provided the perfect conditions for hydropower. In the late 19th century, a hydro-generating plant was installed at Lynmouth on the North Devon coast to supply electricity to the town, one of the first of its kind in the UK. Today, the most enduring application of water power is the Linton and Lynmouth Cliff Railway, built in 1890. Using just water and gravity to drive its funicular rail cars, it links the small harbour village of Lynmouth with the clifftop town of Linton, perched high above. I've come to find out why it was built and how it works from Chief Engineer and Railway Manager, Ashley Clark.
Ashley, thanks very much for seeing me here today. This particular railway is quite special, isn't it? It's not just here for touristic reasons.
No. It's part of the three-stage plan.
Yeah.
There was plans to build a pier and the Esplanade,
right,
and the railway. And it was all to do with steamers coming across from Wales.
Okay.
Also with the need to get goods that come into the harbour at Lynmouth to Linton.
How did goods get from that sea up that hill before? I mean, what was here?
Well, a picturesque little fishing village.
Yeah.
All the goods and visitors used to come in by boat into the harbour. And then to get to Linton, it was either horse and cart.
Up that hill?
Or walk.
The railway was the brainchild of a group of local financiers who saw the economic potential of linking the harbour with the town. One of them, Sir George Nunes, was also an animal lover and hated seeing the pack horses overloaded with goods struggling up the hill. The result of his compassion is the longest funicular railway in the UK, rising over 492 feet in its ascent to Linton.
What are we looking at here?
This is the main braking system of the railway. It's true hydraulics.
True hydraulics?
No oil, it's water.
OK.
Here we've got the grip brake mechanism, which is operated from the driver's brass hand wheel.
I see, so this is literally just going to grip onto this rail.
That's right. Very similar to a disc brake on a car.
Sure, yeah.
The rail is the disc.
Yeah, but the pressure of the water is going to power the brake.
Absolutely.
To grip onto that rail as well.
Absolutely.
I love to see all the workings of Victorian machinery. When it's all polished up, it looks fantastic as well, doesn't it?
That's right, yeah.
As well as using water to power the braking mechanism, simple hydrophysics drives the two cars, which are connected by steel wire ropes.
It's a counterbalance of weights of water, is that right?
That's right. Each car has a 700-gallon tank under it.
Yeah.
Both cars are full with water.
Yeah.
Upon a given signal from the drivers take their brakes off.
Yeah.
Nothing happens, the bottom car is the heavier car.
And one has to release that water to let the other one go?
That's right, yeah.
Sounds so simple now it's invented and up and running, but what a genius idea. Talk to me about the people who use this now. I mean, how long would it take you to do the alternative, i.e. walk up the road?
Depends how fit you are, really, right. But about half an hour.
So this is, I mean, this is a massive time saver, even today.
Absolutely. There aren't many forms of transport. Even if you drove up in a car, you're not going to beat the Cliff Railway.
And after a journey time of just 2.5 minutes, I've arrived at the top, where the view of the North Devon coastline is one to be savoured.
Well, it's a lovely ride up here, but that view is even better than I'd hoped. It's a beautiful, beautiful vista, isn't it? You've got plenty of eager passengers awaiting there, right? So I'll bid you farewell. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Johnny.
All the best.
How fascinating to have experienced this heritage mode of transport, which not only exists to serve a practical purpose, but is also enjoyed by thousands of visitors to this spot each year.
Well, that's three fantastic properties we've shown to Nigel and Lorraine. And as good as those reactions were that we saw at the mystery property, let's not forget how well house number one and two went. Let's see which their favourite is. Now then, you've had a bit of time to think, haven't you? I've got a sneaky suspicion of which property is your favourite, but anything can happen.
The mystery house was probably our favourite out of the three. Fabulous house with the swimming pool and the sauna. I mean, it was just amazing. The self-contained annex on the house could be let out as a holiday let.
Not at all.
But the landscaping of the grounds is really beautiful.
So that's your favourite that you both agree on?
I think it's up there, but we haven't discounted house number one either, actually.
No.
That's going to be a tough decision to make.
Very hard. Very hard, because they're both really good in such different areas.
What's the next step?
Yep.
Call the agent and have another viewing of house one.
Uh-huh.
And I think a lot of other questions that we might have for the mystery house, we can also channel through the agent.
But I think looking at house one on a on a sunny day, I think that's going to make your decision even harder to make.
Possibly.
Possibly.
Do please let us know what you decide on doing. Very best of luck to you.
Thank you very much.
Well, I must say, I've really enjoyed looking around this beautiful part of Devon with a very healthy budget. And surprisingly, well, property number one is running the mystery house pretty close. So it's all down to that all-important second viewing. But whatever, Lorraine and Nigel decide, I'm sure, just like me, you wish them both the very best of luck. See you next time.
If you would like to escape to the country in Northern Ireland, Scotland, Wales or England and need our help, you can apply online at bbc.co.uk/beonashow.